Welcome to Gay Nerd Love.
This is what we talk about when we're not doing it. I'm Andy.
I'm Archie, and we are streaming to you on YouTube live from Portland, Oregon, USA.
Yes. And just a quick note, this is a podcast or videocast or audiocast for adults, so there will be adult content and or there could be adult content. We don't always guarantee there will be adult content, but we just want to warn the people out there that we're two grown-ups and we talk like ones.
And if you're watching instead of just listening, please subscribe to our web series.
Yes, please.
Yes, you can find it. I don't know if you're watching it on the
app,
the browser or the YouTube app. Just click that subscribe button, and
it won't hurt.
That's right.
Tell your friends.
Tell your friends about.
Blah blah blah. Because we don't have advertisers. We don't. This is totally seat of our pants. DIY.
No, we're sharing with you the conversations we actually have all week.
This is really what we talk about. It really is. This is not scripted at all, believe me.
And we, but now that we're on YouTube, we can bring in visual elements.
Pictures.
I like to say that everywhere. Pictures. And video sometimes.
It's the pictures.
All right, so this week we're sort of a... Kind of the opposite of what we did last week. Last week we were talking about AI, like, you know, the projected future of...
Yes. What is, I guess, by most people considered the kind of ultimate goal or the ultimate possible end game of technology or where computers are headed. And so this week we're doing what?
This week we're talking old tech, old technology. And not just computers per se, just... old stuff that people our age, old people.
You're 52 and I'm 51. So.
Right. So some of the older people will recognize these things and some of the much younger.
Post-Gen X.
Yes. Like, what is that? Oh my God, that looks ancient. That looks bulky. That looks...
Dial phones. You know.
Right.
Televisions with antennae.
And...
corded phones.
Oh, right. Yeah.
Phones that don't have screens.
Phones that don't have screens.
Yes. So, yeah. I wanted to start out with a quote, though. This is very often misattributed, I just learned it today, misattributed to Marshall McLuhan. It's actually a quote from a good friend of his, Father John Culkin. And he said, "We shape our tools, and then our tools shape us." And I think that's a good place to start when you're talking about old tech, because I think we have shaped our tools, but our tools have very much. And I think especially our generation, Archie, yours and mine,
right.
The Gen X, I think that was a generation where computers finally tech in quotes, a broader sense, became domesticated.
Like pets?
Yeah.
They were
no,
wild
like,
before?
Like technology moved out of being... outside the home. I mean, you could make the argument that maybe it was the baby boomers where it started in the 50s and 60s, where you suddenly had all these appliances doing things that people used to do with their hands.
Right, and then they're always talking about, oh, how convenient it will be, how it will make your life easier, and that was
right.
A selling point for a lot of tech.
But I don't know if anybody ever actually called it tech or it was actually thought of as technology. It was thought of as appliances and machines, but I don't think of people. People thought, I don't think people necessarily thought, oh, our lives will soon be completely populated by technology, except in those like exhibits of the, you know, home of the future or whatever that you saw in the 60s and 70s. But I think in our generation, we actually thought, okay, technology is now what we're thinking of it as, not just the toaster that beeps when the toast pops up, but everything can be technologicized, or whatever the word would be, technologically either improved or replaced.
Well, some things, I mean, have stayed with us and haven't changed that much. Like, I thought microwaves were magic.
Mm-hmm.
You know, microwave ovens.
Oh, totally. There was no burner. There was no
right.
Thing that got really hot.
It's like it cooked in the air. How does
it cook the air? Yes, it was magic.
And. But microwaves had existed since broadcast.
Yeah, basically.
Media. All right, so I pulled up some YouTube clips, and then you later on you have a We're going to go to YouTube through the browser, but this is stuff that I've stored, and we're just going to go through it. So I, about the for me, the framework of this episode would be things that, at least from my side, things that I actually owned.
Right.
Because I can speak more, you know, from a more informed place about them. My experience with that tech.
So, right. So, I mean, that's all we speak from here. We're not reviewers. This podcast or whatever it is not.
There's plenty of that.
There's plenty of that out there, and we're not talking about new stuff. We're not historians, discussing or analyzing old stuff. As academic as I may get at times, this is really the way I talk. We're just commenting. We're just saying, well, yeah, this was my experience, and it's kind of like I don't think we could possibly consider ourselves official geek pundits when we refuse to basically discuss comic books, because that just, you know, I don't know anybody who's got geek cred that completely says
comic
I just
books
not into comics.
And gaming, unless it's pinball.
Right, exactly. So, you know.
So let's get on with it. The first one that I brought up is, look at this. Check this out.
What is that strange creature? Is it a cell phone?
No, page net? Phone? What?
What does it do? I remember that.
It's a beeper.
Song. You know, I had one only at the very end of beepers because my job wanted me to be on call back in the late 90s.
Uh-huh.
Otherwise, I never had one. I never wanted one.
That is the exact model of beeper I had, and there were many.
So you had one for work or for your own use?
Motorola dominated
right.
Beeper. I will tell you that at the time that I owned a beeper, I'm pretty sure this is a story I never told on the show.
Okay.
I was in Job Corps.
So what year was this?
This would have been in 86, I think.
Okay.
I was in Job Corps, which is, you know, a program for 20-somethings to learn some vocational trade. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the agreement or the exchange you make is that you will live on campus. Most people mm-hmm. will, or you could live off campus, but if you stay on campus, your meals are paid for and everything, and you get a paycheck while you learn.
Right.
So, as Job Corps was going, as I went along, one of the things that they said, well, okay, so you have all these certificates, but now, basically, you're almost graduating from the program, so you need to go get a job.
Okay.
So I got a beeper just so that I could be paged by family, friends, and possible employers.
Oh, that makes sense, yeah.
The job I got was security guard in an adult bookstore.
Makes sense. Okay.
and my job was to keep people from stealing.
Mm-hmm.
And keep people from jerking off.
Good luck.
In the booth.
And how successful were you at that?
Fairly successful.
What techniques did they say were allowed and what were not?
Oh, what techniques?
Did you use harsh language? Did you ever have to throw somebody physically out of the store?
I didn't have any security guard experience. I mean,
that's why I'm asking.
Well, some queens ran it. And they were very nice. Okay. They had a dorm fridge full of snacks and food that I was welcome to. The guy who came in to collect the quarters would put dozens of credits of porn on the booth closest to me.
When you say quarters, you're referring to?
Tokens, actually.
Or tokens. You're referring to machines that showed adult films, right?
Right.
Okay.
Well, adult video, right?
Videos, right.
And that's old tech too, right?
That's what I'm saying. Is that people say adult bookstore? We need to clarify exactly what was there. It wasn't all books.
So the kids
may not know that.
Just to pass through this story, because it is of the period. One guy, they had fired the guard before me because he was armed. Legally, but he ran after a shoplifter firing at him down the sidewalk.
Oh, wow, went all Beretta on it.
Right. So they went to unarmed guards. That's how I got the job. And so in my short time there, I busted a guy who had 11 books tucked under his magazines tucked under his shirt.
Wow, that's skill.
So it was this big square, like he was pregnant with porn.
Amateurs.
He was porn pregnant. And the other time, to answer your question about guys masturbating, I would go over and say, excuse me, sir, you can't do that here.
That's kind. That's what, in the terminology of the gay community, LGBTQQIIAP2X or 2S, that would be sex positive.
Yeah, so to wrap up that beeper story, at the time that I owned a beeper was when I was a security guard in a porn store, an adult bookstore.
Wow. Did anybody who saw you carrying a beeper at that time jokingly or otherwise insinuate that you were a drug dealer? Because I remember when that was just the... When people were first starting to use beepers, people joked that there were two types of people that had beepers. There were like high-end businessmen and drug dealers. And I was wondering if that was ever a stereotype or misapprehension that people had. In other words, were you an early adopt? Were you one of the earliest, like were you one of the few people you knew who had a beeper, or did everybody have them at that point?
Not everyone had them. I was the only one. I was one of the few in Job Corps that had one.
Okay. Interesting.
But no one ever said to my face that they thought I was a drug dealer.
Understood.
Why? Because I was black in South Central?
Maybe. Oh, I don't know. I mean, shit, I got joked at when I was, you know, a late adopter, but, you know, maybe that's just because they know my sense of humor. But, yeah.
And it was, I was going to bring it up again.
I like the quiet soundlessness.
Yes.
It's like...
PageNet might have been the actual store I went to. Oh, my God, it's the very beeper I owned. No, I mean...
Those are not your hands.
But the later ones would scroll messages across.
Yes,
but this
that's
one,
right.
This one just showed the number. It just beeped when someone was calling you.
Not
and it
message,
also, that
right.
little arrow there with on the white... button, mm-hmm. You could scroll through the number of messages you had that way.
Right, so. Right. Interesting. So
this was
RG's first real tech, I guess, or not your first tech.
It's not my first tech,
but your first example you're going to use today.
Yes, I mean, we could almost make. I mean, we could do it easily a 2 or 3 part show, but we're just going to talk about it this episode. There's tons of stuff we're not going to talk about that qualifies as old tech that. Either we had have experience with or came across, but let's. I was going to go through a quick list of things we're not talking about. But let's just stick to what we're going to talk about. You're not going to say, "Hey, this is a list of things you're not going to hear about." No,
yes, let's have a positive model, not a let's have an additive, not a subtractive model. That's true.
Yes. Okay. Here's the next. We're going straight to the next thing.
Oh, man. I loved Selectric typewriters.
This is the best thing that's happened to typing since electricity. The IBM Selectric typewriter. Instead of type bars, there's an ingenious printing element that dances across the paper at incredible speed. Faster even than the eye can see.
In a world.
Now watch in slow motion.
Oh,
as
wow.
It turns, tilts, and prints.
I've always wanted to see this.
This tiny printing element is also interchangeable. Simply remove one type style. Choose another from several distinctive typefaces. And click it into place.
His voice is
takes
so
only 5 seconds.
Is this...
And you're ready to start typing again. Someday all typewriters will work like
this
the
is
IBM
early
Selectric.
Tech porn.
But why wait?
Is what this is. I mean, look at the lighting.
I'm touching myself, man.
The lighting is like amazing. That's wonderful. I'm so glad you put that in there because I remember the first time I saw a Selectric ball typewriter, and I just thought it was the most amazing thing ever. It was just so amazing. And then when I started to actually have access to be able to use one, I think I read somewhere that the IBM company spent $1 million just perfecting the touch of the keys. They did so much
machine. It was so much, so pleasurable to type on that thing.
It feels so good. The touch, the pressure, the click,
I even
the
liked
amount
the
of
sound. The sound
it
was meditative typing.
It was. I loved using these machines, and I know that now there must be groups of like people who still like I'll bet there are typing nerds that collect these things and collectively keep these things working, because it's probably hard to find ribbons, it's probably hard to find parts to keep these machines running. But I wanted one of those so bad to own when I was a kid.
Yeah, we had them in the Navy. Mm-hmm. And that ball was amazing. I mean, how it even worked.
That design is fantastic.
To turn in the, for all those
characters. As quickly
for all those characters.
And not break
it
down. I mean, that's a lot of wear and tear. That machinery in this is fantastic.
And if you didn't secure the ball right, it would just fly
pop
right
up
out of the machine.
Yeah, totally. It was whee.
And then I was a moment of terror. It's like, oh no, I've broken it. And, and then you lose a whole font.
Right.
But yeah, I love typing on Selectrics. And those things in the front, what were those things in the front there?
Margins.
That's right. Those little sliders above the key.
It was the most pleasurable and efficient writing machine ever created.
The most pleasurable and efficient writing machine ever.
Yeah, I mean, it was, in fact, it's interesting because the attention to detail that IBM put into that machine carried over into their early keyboards of the 286 and 386 machines. I don't know if you remember the little click, the clickety-click keyboards of the very first IBM personal computers. They had a very similar touch. In fact, I believe that you can find, people have reverse generated keyboards that can use it, or USB compatible, that have the same touch.
Oh, okay.
For computers today, because they felt so good and they wrote so well, because IBM just knew their shit.
They patented the touch, surely, right?
Surely, of course, the technology for that. So yeah. I wonder how many millennials or whatever will ever have the, opportunity to sit down to a Selectric typewriter and feel what that felt like.
I remember them being pretty quiet, too.
For the most part, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't hear, I guess what I'm saying, I didn't hear a motor running.
Oh, but, yeah.
Yeah, but I heard someone else say that they were very noisy. But my historical memory is that the whole experience was this fun.
Was a reverie.
I think that also added to your, it probably added to the
aesthetic experience?
No, the efficiency of the typist, the words
yes.
per minute, it increased your words per minute because
yes.
it was so easy.
Ask any administrative assistant, or when they used to be called secretaries in the day back when these were in common use, and they'll tell you, oh yeah, yeah. My mother, who was a medical transcriptionist, she transcribed medical records. Doctors would tape the transcription for their medical record, and then my mother would be one of the women in this typing pool in the hospital in Lewiston, Idaho. And so she had one of these, and she said, yeah, it was fantastic that it was, it made typing so much easier. It had, remember the lift-off correction tape that could just you could just go back and correct? It would remember what you wrote, so you just go back, and you wouldn't even have to remember what you typed.
Oh, that's right. Remember what, and the, yeah. So probably a lot of government offices and,
yep.
and had those. And I remember, like I said, I remember having them in the military. So, and my mother temped a lot mm-hmm. working in offices. And I know she's probably had a lot of experience with the Selectric, just like yours did.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I wonder where all those went. There must have been millions of those typewriters in just the government alone. No, I mean, I'm talking about when a government office would completely transfer over to computers.
Oh, well, I know that they have auctions. And people buy a lot of it. It's probably in other countries.
Like I said, there's probably groups that keep this alive the way we want to keep pinball alive, that it's
right.
like this specialty niche thing now. So what are you at next?
Next is... Kim-nip-nip.
Bamping, bamping.
Kodak announces a whole new way to make pictures. Introducing disc photography.
We're talking floppies.
The beginning is this, a unique film disc. A disc so thin there's room in the camera for an array of precision electronics. The new Kodak disc camera.
Oh.
single button, and the new Kodak disc camera does it all. It reads the light. It knows when to flash and can flash again in 1 1/3 seconds. It even advances the film disc automatically, so you can capture those wonderful moments you may have been missing. The new Kodak disc camera.
To picture that brand new world.
Oh, I can picture a lot of things. I can picture the fact that no matter how many fancy electronics you pack into a camera, if the lens is going to stay that small, and if the actual area of the film that's being exposed is going to stay the same size as a 110 camera, which is about what it was, you're not going to improve the quality at all.
No, the pictures weren't good.
They were shitty.
But it's funny. There's that window in the, I say, mid '80s where a lot of these things came out.
Yes.
And I also happened to be in the Navy, so I had the money, the extra income to buy these things because I was already into whatever the latest interesting tech was.
Uh-huh.
And so I bought this camera, and the first thing I noticed was It's not even as good as an Instamatic.
No, it was just they took the 110 camera and just flattened it. And I'm noticing here too. See, I never owned a disc camera, so I really didn't pay a lot of attention to the design.
You didn't picture a brand new world?
No, I did not, sadly. Which explains a lot. But look at putting the shutter release right there on the front of the camera. That looks awkward to me. The
right.
Pressure. I mean, how would you hold the camera steady and still push the front of the camera? It reminds me of the way we still, for the most part, have camera apps for cell phones are designed that you have to push the screen in a place that makes no sense in terms of holding your cell phone and then being able to take a decent picture. With the exception of some cameras some phones that actually have attachments, like I had with my Windows phone, which had this really great attachment, which put the shutter release on top where a camera shutter release would be.
It seems like they were just trying stuff out. Say, hey, well, since it's a complete redesign, we have to do everything differently. We have to move the button around. It's interesting, the flash is still in the same place.
Yeah, well, and what's also interesting is this was just after they had pioneered in the late 70s a digital camera. Kodak had a digital camera.
Oh, Kodak fucked
They went with this because, well, I mean, think about what they were thinking at the time. Do we really want to create something that's going to completely decimate our number one market, which is film? So instead of doing that, they just kind of said, oh, well, that's clever. Let's put that unicorn in the barn and, you know, build something that people will continue to buy and need to buy film every time they want to take a picture. And they had the opportunity there to be in on the basement, if not the ground floor, of the digital camera market, and they completely fucked it up.
So did Polaroid.
Yep.
Polaroid had a chance,
yep,
too. And they have to be kicking themselves, right?
Oh, I'm sure.
I remember that. What was that sliding cover? Was that the wide-angle lens?
I think it was just the lens cover.
A lens cover.
I think it was.
All right. Well, then what's the thing in the middle?
I think it's the sensor for the flash.
Right. The flash sensor. No, I think you're right.
But yeah, I wasn't really into photography as much as I am now at the time. And so I wasn't really paying a lot of attention to, you know, the latest in consumer photography, whatever. But I just remember seeing these and just thinking, well, that looks, you know, futuristic, but it didn't set me on fire. So I never bought one.
And I just want to say a global thing about all these things that I owned. I have no idea where they went.
I was just going to ask.
I moved around a lot. I could have given them away. I could have sold them. I could have, you know, donated them. Who knows?
Well, we still find disc cameras at Goodwill.
Oh, sure.
That come through there, you know, along with, you know, 8mm movie cameras and stuff like that.
Yes, and I believe I've seen, like, you know, you see all manner of old typewriter there, too.
Yes. And I maintain that because everything's moving with the cloud, everything's moving to Wi-Fi, everything is happening in such a way that tech is networked and connected together, that it's very possible that one of the most valuable things in the future is going to be a typewriter. that in order to write something out and to put data down in a way that's completely air-gapped and completely out of the purview of someone's prying eyes, then a typewriter is going to be the way to go. And I think it's going to be interesting to see in the next 10 or 20 years if things get as pervasive in terms of computers just being everywhere and being connected to everything and literally listening to us. People are installing Alexas and having their phones with Cortana and Siri, and everything is supposedly created in such a way as to make things more and more convenient for us. Well, part of that bargain that we're making is this kind of constant domestic surveillance. So it's going to be interesting if someone is going to want to do anything entirely private or even subversive, then the only way they're going to be able to send information to each other is written. And it's going to probably be a typewriter because writing is just, you know, much slower. So go out there and buy an electric typewriter, make it work, and hide it in a closet and wait for the fascists to take over, I guess.
Oh, and it'll have to be passed person to person, is that what you're saying?
Exactly. I think hackers will move retro in that sense. If hackers are going to be like anonymous or whatever, either they're going to, you know, try and outwit the computer
people.
Secure information will be able to be passed by typewriter. Because you can't, unless you could go through the ribbon and figure out what the person typed by looking at the ribbon. But that would require somebody breaking in and stealing the ribbon. So anyway, there's the plot for a novel for your 1984-esque dystopian pro-typewriter, anti-technology, whatever.
All right. Well, I tried to organize as best I could these clips into areas. So we're going to move away from like personal, professional items, I'd say. Items you use like in your job or in a... anyway, let's move on to the next thing. You'll see it. Anyway, we're done with that section.
Okay.
Now, this is cool because I brought this up because, yes, there are other black nerds besides me. I have proof
Blurs.
Now. I found them on the, what do you call them?
Blurds.
Blurds? You just made that up.
No, I didn't. Larry Wilmore popularized.
There's actually a word called blur. Larry Wilmore from Larry Wilmore Show.
Correct.
What is the lasting legacy of the zip disk and the zip drive? In September of 1998, a class action lawsuit was filed against iOmega claiming a type of zip drive failure nicknamed the Click of Death and accused iOmega of violations of the Delaware Consumer Fraud Act. Sales of the zip drives and disks declined steadily from 1999 to 2003, as zip disks had a higher cost per megabyte compared to the falling costs of the then new CD writable and rewritable disks. The growth to multi-gigabyte capacity sizes and hard disk drives made backing up the zip disks less practical and economical.
Wow, I don't remember the 750 disks, but I'm sure they were available. But those were like crack when they first came out. We just those of us who were doing lots of photography or graphic design stuff, who needed a file-saving, rewritable format that was more durable than CD. We loved these things. I had a drive right away.
Yeah, they were built like tanks.
They were great. And then, yes, the click of death. Oh, man. Few things made your heart sink more than the click of death when they would just click, 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 click. And, you know, it's like, why? Why did this happen? But it happened.
Yeah, I liked that drive for some reason. Because everything about the zip, like I was saying, built like a tank, everything about the zip disk and drive felt sturdy. Drives felt sturdy, the disk felt sturdy. I'm trying to remember, did the drive have a rescue thing where you could eject the disk if it did do the click of death or not? Like you could push a safety, not a safety pin.
I don't remember.
But a paperclip in there, a hole, a rescue hole?
I would not be surprised. It would not surprise me, but I do not remember. Jet it's been tool. So long since I've had one.
I was trying to remember. I was trying to remember what, because I think I did use it for backup because I didn't at the time. I didn't own any computer that couldn't be backed up to a disk drive. I didn't have a lot of stuff on my hard drive that couldn't be backed up to a disk drive. I'm trying to think of anything specific. Probably photos.
Music. Did you have your music at all, or were you not an MP3 person?
I was not an MP3. Was MP3 around at that time?
The early days, it was probably getting close to it. Yeah, I think
like early that 90s, or at early least, 90s.
I think people were burning their CDs to a file that they could listen to Windows Media Format. So it may not have been MP3 yet. It may not have been compressed yet.
Oh, sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, and so the industry, the zip industry died because of CDs.
Pretty much. It was kind of like, I think it was kind of like Betamax versus VHS, and VHS being CDs, which are still around. DVDs are still around. But you're right that I liked the zip and other drives because they were like storage on steroids. They were like a floppy disk on steroids. They felt firm, and they felt like you could drop them and not worry, or you could carry them around in your pocket in their little plastic case. Whereas CDs just felt thin and wispy and scratchable and breakable.
And if you watch later after the show's over, we'll put up I'll put up links to all these videos. But this guy, this blurred, as you call him, he also in his presentation corrects people that the 3.5-inch disc, while called a floppy, was technically not a floppy because floppy discs were flexible.
Correct. The last true floppy was the 5.25, right?
Right.
And the next thing down was not a floppy disk; it was a diskette. It was a plastic diskette.
Diskette.
So.
Yeah. Why is it fun to say diskette?
Oh, I don't know. It sounds, I don't know, it sounds vaguely femme.
Oh.
You know, it because you E-T-T-E. Oh, the grammar police are coming for me now.
Oh, right.
No. This show is live. I think it's the diminution of the word et, E-T-T-E, meaning smaller. So I think smaller usually means funny.
Oh, that could be it.
That's my theory, and I'm sticking with it.
The biggest, the oldest, biggest disc I had was in the Navy, and it was a 5.25.
It wasn't the 8-inch ones, the big ones that were like that, like a square tile.
Oh.
Do you remember those? Those were like only, I think, used in like big mega computers. I don't think those were
No, it was
the 5.5 or 5.25.
The 5.5?
Something like that.
It was a big one. Yep. It was somewhere between the 5.5 and that giant one that you described, because I remember the disk drive. It was a word processor. I remember the disk drive portion just being this, you know, this sort of this skinny. I wish I had a picture of it. I don't even remember what model it was, but I just remember the disk being huge, and you put it in there and then click. Lock it in, and it would go crunch, 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 crunch.
I remember those days. My first computers were, well, actually, no. My first computer was the Commodore, and with that, the only option you had at first was the tape drive using audio tapes, and that was always fraught.
Couldn't find where the program was.
Never figure. That was just always hell. But yeah.
Yeah. So that was the short life of the zip.
And it was a bright comet in the sky of tech, and then it burned its way out. I wonder if iOmega is even around anymore. I assume they probably are in some capacity, but. They flamed out quickly, but they flamed brightly.
Yes. Next we have...
Yes. Wah, wah, wah.
This looks like someone ordered it off of eBay.
Picked it up out of a trunk. Oh, it's just like the nerd version of Operation. Find these at Goodwill.
Yes, you do. So I'm just lowering the music behind the music bed so we can actually talk over it. Yeah, my uncle worked for Motorola at the time.
Okay.
He had one of the first car phones.
Wow.
The big brick with the phone
baby
on
nuke.
Top. Yes. And he used to give me an electronic project kit, not every birthday or Christmas, but almost, because I think he wanted me to get into electronics. And I did, for a certain to a certain point, and then it's like I wanted to play around, and then I moved on to the next thing. I didn't really want to become another. Oh, the CDS, the CDS cell. Oh, I should back that up. So what he's doing now, he's doing one of the projects called a light controlled electronic heart, but really, it's just called calling it a theremin, people wouldn't know what it meant.
Nerdgasm. Look at the little dolls are watching. Sounds like one of those little electronic birds. Ah, yes. Days of yore. This is what hooked a lot of us of our generation on tech, was making it into a puzzle toy.
Yeah, I was going to back up and get sort of a better shot of the... It had a lot going on in the kit. There was a relay, a light, a transformer, a tuner, and the ferrite rod there, so you can make an AM radio. They had a digital, one of those red digital numerical displays. It had a solar cell. Mm-hmm. There was a bunch of stuff.
Itty bitty little solar cell.
And the manual had, of course, the diagram. You know, you use these little springs and color-coded wire. Although it doesn't matter what color of the wire it was. Actually, I take that back. It did, because depending on the color indicated the length of the wire. And in the manual, it would also show you the schematic. Mm-hmm. So if you were really into electronics, you could actually learn to read the schematic and go and build the thing that you were making with right. springs and wires.
Right.
But I remember at the time, I can't remember which kit my uncle bought me, but I remember at the time what are some of the things I made? I liked the... And this was a staple in Star Trek, the original series, the voice-activated light.
Oh, yeah, totally.
So you'd speak into the microphone and the light would blink to your voice.
So you were Zardong, one of the old ones in, you know, some episode.
Yeah, the microphone is, or the speaker. I think it doubled as both in the upper right. But you'd speak into that, and that relay on the far left would click, and the light would blink. What else did I build? I built the countdown clock. I did a solar-powered AM radio.
Oh, cool.
The crystal radio, because it came with a little earphone. And you could listen, you know, crystal radio, you could listen to AM signals without battery power.
Right.
What else did I do? Up there in the center there, you can't really see it, but there's a meter. My uncle, he was always tinkering with electronics because he sold them for a living. Mm-hmm. But at home, he was always working in his garage. So I could, this takes me back. I could walk over to visit because my mother and I lived in the rear unit, which he owned, the rear apartment. Mm-hmm. I'd walk into his garage and the smell of solder.
Mm-hmm.
that is such a distinct.
That's probably a triggering. It is. For you now.
It is. When I smell solder, I remember, "Hi, Uncle Wood," and he'd be, "Hi, Archie," and he'd be hovered over. He'd have a desk lamp aimed at some circuit that he was soldering, hovered over that, and we'd talk about it. And I played with solder, but I didn't like the smell because you know how sensitive I am to odors,
yes.
And for somehow that curl of the burning, whatever it was, would go right up to my nose, even though I was trying, even with a fan or somehow it would find me. But one thing, I remember him taking an AM, I'm sorry, taking a regular radio and re-soldering it to make it a transmitter.
Oh.
And it was so powerful, he got scared and disconnected it.
Oh, that's interesting.
But I remember when I had the 151 kit, I did what he, and I don't know how I did it. It was purely by accident. I took the radio transmitter, the FM radio transmitter, and rewired it. I mean, the receiver, and rewired it to be a transmitter. Mm-hmm. And I could talk into my kit and hear it on the home radio.
That must have been exciting.
It was. But I got scared too when I stopped. the range was probably only like 25 feet, but still, I didn't know, you know, because it was.
Feds are gonna come get you.
They're gonna get you.
You haven't got your license.
But yeah, that brings back memories, and I'm thinking, this is an assumption, but the people who order these probably know more about electronics than. It's just a nostalgia thing. They probably know a lot about, like, it's probably got them started in whatever career path they.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised. The same way that, you know, a VIC-20 or a Commodore 64 will make me tingle and remember the days of when I was trying to learn basic programming or trying to make an animation or I remember one of my first basic programs that I created myself was create a computer program that would find the launch code, the way that the computer was looking for the launch code in War Games. Yeah, so I created one that would look for this, you know, do a randomizer thing, and if it equals this letter, then move on, write it, you know, type it, and then move on. And I was so proud of myself that I could make that work, and then they make the computer find the code. And
oh yeah, so, I remember BASIC. I liked BASIC. Mm-hmm. You know, it's obsolete now because you don't need it, but at the time, you really felt like you were like a programmer. I wrote a basic program that had ASCII character fencers, sword fighters.
Oh.
And you'd use the
keys on your keyboard,
the forward and reverse arrow keys to advance or retreat, and then I think it was the space bar to lunge.
Oh wow!
The ASCII knight or whatever character on the left was the player, and then the one on the right was the AI, was the software. The
right.
AI. Except I had to when I first wrote it, the computer was too smart. The program was too smart. It won every time.
Right.
And it had three moves. It could stab you in the neck, in the chest, or in the crotch. Because I wasn't sure where to aim the ASCII character sword.
Would point you.
But the computer would win every time. So I had to put in a randomizer to make it a little dumb.
Sure.
You know, so it would miss, you know, so you would win. And it actually kept score, too.
Oh, that's cool.
So I wish I had that program just to, you know, there's a lot of, and we're not going to talk about software, but, you know, that could be a whole other show just about retro software tech.
Sure.
But let's move on to the next thing that happened across my path. Again, this is in that mid-80s window where a lot of things were being sold off, you know. There was there's the video game death and a lot of things that companies made that didn't sell well.
It's drumming for deaf people.
I'm having a problem with my my mouse.
You took that down. Regular guy.
Let's try that again. Elton John's drummer. Regular guy.
With a built-in computer, new Synsonics drums means you can play like a pro, even if you've never played before.
Oh, Mattel Electronics.
Synsonics drums. Had you ever seen these or played
I
with them?
I knew of them, yeah, but I never played them, no.
They were fun. There were a lot of complaints about the sensitivity of the pads weren't great. Mm. I mean, I should say they weren't consistent. You could hit them with your fingers. You could hit them with sticks. I think they were better with sticks than your fingers. And those buttons at the bottom were for programming and recording.
Right.
and you can't really see it in this shot, but on the left, to the left of the, in between the two pads on the left, was a wheel where you could change the pitch of the uh-huh. drum.
Okay.
And I don't think I owned this for very long either, but I thought it was very cool. I think I bought it new. You know,
what did it cost?
I do not remember. A lot of this old tech does end up at Goodwill. And if right. you're fortunate enough to come across
out,
it.
And when it's first out, it's expensive.
It is.
Early adopter tech is always like way priced, and they price it that way because they know that there's this core audience. They're going to make this huge kind of Christmas-like windfall, and then once it starts to get adopted, they know that they bring the price point down, they'll grow their market. But that's been perfected at this point. But yeah.
Oh, because they know that market's out there. I don't think they know. Would you say they probably didn't know it at the time that
I think they were just learning how to do that then, at the point that we're talking about here. Now it's, you know, an art. It's got all algorithms that can predict this stuff. But at the time, probably not.
Yeah, and the only time so there are people who own them now. I was watching YouTube videos, and they've done a lot more with them. I mean, you can search on YouTube and see people doing. They've circuit bent them so that they make more noise, make different noises. The thing I remember doing with my Synsonics I was so proud of is that there's a sound that sounds very much like sort of like an electronic snare,
uh-huh.
and I took. Prince's I Would Die For You,
mm-hmm.
I found a drum sound with the Synsonics that approximated that, then I overdubbed my sound over I Would Die For You.
And you just felt so like the shit,
oh,
didn't you?
Well, my uncle's wife, my Aunt Doris, I said, listen to this, Aunt Doris, look what I did.
You know, uh-huh.
I didn't really do anything but sort of overlaid the same similar sound, but I was so proud of that.
Sure.
But this is one of those things where I was not a drummer. I had no aspirations to be a musician. I just liked the idea that you could doing, and I guess that's sort of my, the way I am with a lot of tech. And unless I have a specific application for it, like the studio software I'm using to run the show, or the mixer, or the computer, mm-hmm. I'm just playing with it just to learn, you know, just to experience it.
Sure.
Is that yours? Your experience with a lot of tech?
Yeah, I think that I was a dabbler. I mean, with a lot of different things. I wish I'd stuck more with computers at the time because I was an early adopter on that. I was. You know, as soon as I knew that the VIC-20 was available, I mean, even before that, I played with touched my first quote-unquote personal computer back in the late 70s when my parents and I were on a vacation to Seattle because we didn't live there. I didn't live there yet. I lived in Lewiston, Idaho, and we were on our way to Vancouver, but we stopped in Seattle and we went to the Pacific Science Center, which was like, you know, Disneyland for me because it was just geek tech and everything. And they had a Commodore PET computer, the forerunner of the later VIC-20 consumer models and the Commodore 64 and then later the Amiga. But the PET was, Commodore was a Canadian company, and I believe the PET was designed for schools, I believe. It was this pyramid-shaped thing. And that was my first experience of, like, you know, oh, wow, look, a computer, and I can, like, do stuff with it and keyboard and all that. And I played with it, and I just was immediately transfixed, and I was like, I want to get one. I want to have a home computer. And I wasn't techie in the sense that I would get the, like, home electronic kit. That intimidated me. But instead, I was interested in getting the like the home version, and I even thought about getting an Atari computer, because when they first came out, the Atari 400, I think, they didn't even have a decent keyboard on it. It had like little, you know, press buttons. But I ended up getting a VIC-20 and dabbled with, you know, computers that way for a while, and even did a little bit of programming, got a Commodore, and I wish I'd stuck with it. But yeah, I didn't get into the point where I went and, you know, went to computer science class or did any of that, but, you know.
You regret not sticking with it because what?
Because I could have made more money. Because I could have actually gotten into the business like a lot of other people did early in the early days and learned it and, you know, grew with it and did all of that. There are lots of people that were my age at the time that became full-on nerds and computer nerds and, you know, went into the biz.
Now, see,
I think I was more artistic. I didn't have the math side of it down at all. That intimidated me away from it, I think. I liked the artistic and creative side, but no, the math stuff and the more technical stuff intimidated
me. The engineering part too, right?
Yes. I mean, you know, I was a space nut. I loved spaceships.
You're a far out space nut.
I was not a far out space nut, but I was a fan of NASA and the space program. I remember getting up early in the morning, about 5 o'clock Pacific time, so I could watch the test of the space shuttle engines before it even, you know, took off or whatever. And I remember we're coming up on September 5th is going to be the anniversary of the launch of Voyagers 1 and 2 and how exciting that was for me. And I remember seeing the live pictures come in. So, you know, so yeah, I was a dabbler.
Yeah. I mean, I could definitely see that suiting your analytical mind. But you really need the math.
I think if somebody had just pushed me, I would have gotten and realized I had it. I just didn't know at the time I had it.
How did you do in math?
I was crap. I was really bad.
I was bad in math too. I got as far as algebra one, and then my brain just fried. I was like, what?
I got as far as the eighth grade, and then quit the public school system because I was being teased mercilessly for being gay. And ironically, the place I went in that I fled to was a Christian school that was so strict, I knew I wouldn't get teased at all. And unfortunately, the school I went to was like a homeschooler type schooling where the people who were it was all self-done. You just did workbooks all day. You didn't have teachers. And the women who were kind of like the monitors or whatever, they weren't teachers. They didn't have training. And so that was fine for kids up through the sixth or seventh grade, but when you started getting into high school math and things like that, they didn't know. And so I hit a brick wall when I hit algebra. I never took trig. I never took anything above algebra because I had the same thing. When I got to algebra, I fried. So yeah.
You were gay in the eighth grade.
Oh, I was always gay. I never had a girlfriend. I've never kissed a girl romantically in my life. So yeah. Gay from go. But yeah. So yeah, I had the same thing with algebra. I hit it and I couldn't get it and there was nobody around to explain it to me. And I often wonder sometimes in that, you know, alternative timeline thinking that if I'd stayed in school or if I'd gotten a tutor earlier, if I would have been able to figure out a way to understand math. Because once I think I started to understand a system, I'm really good at systems analysis. I just, at the time, I was intimidated and I didn't like to fail, so. Plus, I think when you're a smart kid, when you're young, when you're early, and they tell you you're gifted and all those things, I think it can sometimes become an impediment because you become used to being the smart kid in the class, so you shy away from any way being not the smart kid. Do you know what I mean?
I know exactly what you mean.
You run away
I mean,
from things that you know you can't be the best at.
We were
you can't
both
be the smartest one at.
In gifted children's programs.
Yep.
It's funny because my mother says now.
And I'm glad I was.
My mother says, well, I am too. I mean, I took a college level class when I was 10.
Right.
It was herpetology. It was so cool. We went and examined fossils and all that stuff. But my mother, she I don't know how she feels about it now because we haven't talked about it. But I remember she expressed at one time some regret about putting me in the gifted children's program because all the other kids knew. And you know,
and in the tribalism
of school, I was treated differently.
Yeah.
And what I did to try to counter that, like you were just talking about, is I goofed around. I was the smart ass in the back of the room.
I was the same thing. I was the class clown. And I think that there's a whole dynamic there for a whole couple of generations where
it wasn't cool to be smart.
There wasn't advanced placement classes then. For us. And so there wasn't a track to create and find your tribe. You were just the smart nerd that, you know, turned into Judd Nelson from The Breakfast Club rather than being Anthony Michael Hall. You became kind of the fuck up or you became kind of the the goof off, and you had all this ability, but you weren't using it because you were afraid that you would just immediately dig deeper the grave of being uncool in school.
Now, you went as far as eighth grade public before you went private.
And never went back to public schools.
Yeah, and I was in public the whole time. And I was in, and we talked about this on other shows. I was in urban public schools. Mm-hmm. And I don't know how it is now, but black kids did not value, I'm talking about my experience in Inglewood.
I think it's still, yeah.
Inglewood and Crenshaw High did not value smarts.
Why are you trying to be so white?
Why are you trying to be so bougie? You're trying to be white?
But bougie. You think you're better than us, don't you? You're going to speak right, aren't you?
Trying to speak, speak properly.
Yeah, yeah. I
was picked on. I was beaten up. You know, I was robbed a lot. People took my shit. They took my lunch money. They took my bike. Because I seemed weak because I was insecure. Well, I was insecure about being smart.
People saw smart as weak.
And gay,
strong.
And also gay.
Right.
Right. And I wasn't as openly gay as you were, so at that age, but I knew who I was, and
I wasn't openly gay then either.
Okay, there was
at that age,
and I made some poor choices. Like I wrote a love letter to a boy, and he told everybody.
Oh, man.
I was in 10th grade or 11th grade.
Oh my God!
And
you
that was like
mortified.
A really dumb.
You must
dumb
have been
choice.
Just mortified.
And
though.
I was mortified. We're in the same class. We were in drama. And
oh my God!
And I thought, you know,
you need to write a play about this.
Well, I guess somewhere in my brain, I thought the drama kids were cooler than the rest.
See, I think that's a stereotype that's really interesting, and that's true. They're not. That when there's that pressure to be with the crowd, and if the crowd is not with you, there is a sudden vicious turning of like, you know, burn the witch that happens very fast, and especially when you're young and everyone's going through puberty and they're insecure as hell.
And I didn't think about that at the time. Like I've long since forgiven the guy for how he treated me. Thankfully, he wasn't a fighter. You know,
right.
But you know, seeing him on stage and everything or something, uh-huh. I just gravitated toward him. You know, if I look him up now, he's probably like hit the wall and all fat or whatever. But at the time, I just thought he was
the shit.
Sure. And he didn't exactly, and I've told this story. I think I've told the story in the show. He didn't exactly like out me in front of the class, but he did it almost something almost as worse. It's like during a break, he pulled me aside while in class and sat next to me and told me, you know, told me I was a sick person. And everyone was watching, everyone knew, you know. And
oh my God.
And remember, this is an adult podcast, you know, fuck that cunt of a teacher, because he was gay. I knew he was gay. Never said a word to me. Never.
Oh, the teacher was gay.
The teacher was gay. I knew the teacher was gay.
Well,
I ran into him later in San Diego with his boy toy. Mm-hmm. And we still didn't talk about the fact that we both were gay, even though he was with his boy toy. You know, he was, I think he was in the closet up until the end.
Sure.
And he probably went home and drank for not defending me, but, you know, fuck him. The little boy in me is still hurt by that.
Yeah.
You know,
this is the episode of Stranger Things we'll never get to see. Seriously, right. Somebody needs to be able to write this, because I think it's such a taboo subject, but yeah. Wow.
His name was... He's dead now, so I can say his name. His name was Jacques.
I'll bet it was.
Probably Jack.
Exactly.
Really, right?
It was probably James.
All right, so moving on to the next tech.
And now, moving on with old tech.
Hello?
Hello?
Here we have the SK-1 preset sound.
The SK-1?
Trumpet.
Oh,
human voice.
The keyboard made for people with teeny tiny fingers.
It must have been made for kids, right?
I wonder. I always wondered that when I was a child. I was like, God, these keys are so small.
Synth drums. Probably the most awful preset sound on any keyboard ever.
Now this is as loud as the original
because
video.
Because he's so
is.
Crappy at putting the microphone near the whatever.
You have solo. Which is just monophonic. Solo 2 is monophonic.
So we can talk over it,
and
but
you have a chord mode,
so this thing was very powerful
In terms of what?
For what it... And I like the way he's going through it. If you watch the original, and like I said, we'll have links for these things. But the original video, he uses jump cuts to, in 2 minutes, cover pretty much all the basic features of the, all the features of the thing. But look, it has a generic waveform that you can modify with the keys and then save it so you can make your custom sounds.
Yeah, these were early samplers.
Sampling!
He even picked a retro 70s computer font.
Plugged into the audio in on the back. Sampled that in. The way they do the pitch shifting by shifting the speed of the sample.
You could sample from an audio in and then play it back on the keys.
Oh, yeah. Cool.
Won't be even between keys, which is kind of a shame at times, but you can also work with it.
That's the audio sample that he just got from his iPod, his old iPod.
Oh, yes, iPods. That's considered probably old tech now.
This envelope, you get a nice reverb.
He just whistled into it.
Oh, yeah, see, this is the kind of stuff that when I was a kid, I would have just, you know, played with for hours and hours and hours and pretty much not gotten anything out of it that would be useful afterwards, but other than the experience of having played with it for hours and hours and hours.
And back to Job Corps. Again, this is like the mid-80s thing. Mm-hmm. I owned one of these. I bought one of these and had it in Job Corps and used it as sort of an avenue to get to know dudes, to be cool with guys, you know.
Cool tech.
This is one of the things, I don't have my original, but this is one of the things, that I've shown, I own one. Because I found one at the bins here at the Goodwill where they sell items in bulk.
Right, it's just bin pulls. We have a whole episode of it that went to the bins.
I dug through the bins and found a Casio SK1. The battery cover was off, but the thing worked. I put in four batteries, and I have it. It's in storage, but I bring it out to play with it. But yeah, so all the features that it had, like I said, it had those blue buttons that you can see. One was the generic waveform. Mm-hmm. And then you could modify it with the keys, and then use the other button to save it, and then play that. So that's pretty advanced, and you could customize the sound. Those double rows of keys with the blue and the yellow one beneath, those were rhythms that you could...
Remember.
Right.
Bossa Nova, rock, jazz,
yes, rock,
whatever.
Pop one and pop two, I think.
Exactly.
And then you could also... You could have to the right of the power light. You could have single. You could play just like a single key. You could combine a rhythm and an accompanying track. So you could have bossa nova with an accompanying chords. Mm-hmm. And the far right you can't really see, but that's what he kept blowing into was a sampler. You could save the sampler sound.
Right.
And one of the things I like to do was to. Like scratch the speaker or tap it with a pen, and so when you played the keys, you could almost couldn't hear the sound, the tap. But if you press the loop button, then you would get a you make your own tone.
Yeah,
with it.
That sounds cool. Yeah, I remember these. I always wanted one when I was a kid. I just never got one.
I should bring it back into the apartment so you can play with it.
Sure.
But the keys were just a pain in the ass. They were too small for your fingers. You couldn't really play anything that was that complex. I remember in Job Corps that I sampled, there were a bunch of like metalheads, so I sampled Metallica's song Battery. Battery! That part. You know, the Battery part. You know, we played on the pinball machine. And then I turned it into a funk song.
Oh, that's awesome.
They did not like it.
Really?
No, the metalheads.
Of course not. Of course not.
At first, they were into it because I sampled Metallica. But
and
when
then
it
was like, oh.
When it got funky, they were like, no, thank you.
That's interesting because before this stuff was available, and I think this was something that you experienced as well, if we're going to talk about old tech, correct me if I'm wrong, but one of the first things that you and I both individually, when we were young, turned into toys of creativity was a good old-fashioned cassette tape recorder. right?
Right.
Yeah, I did my own versions of Orson Welles' War of the Worlds broadcast. I think I saw the movie or I heard about it, and I became so fascinated with it. I must have been 7 or 8 years old or 9 years old. And so I would just over and over again, I would try and make my own version of Orson Welles' War of the Worlds. And I don't know, which one was it that you said that you did?
Oh, yeah, we talked about this. I did Jaws.
Oh, that's right. We did mention this, yes.
Jaws in the bathroom.
So that was old tech for us.
A bathroom with a tub full of water.
Yes. Now kids probably use computers and create After Effects and make movies, but, you know. So, yes.
So, moving on.
This is the system chosen 2-1 over Atari and Intellivision for real arcade gameplay.
Fantastic!
Presenting the revolutionary Vectrex arcade system. Ordinary home video games can't match the laser-sharp visual effects of Vectrex. Because only Vectrex has a real arcade screen built in. No TV set needed. So every Vectrex cartridge gives you real arcade gameplay that others can't. Vectrex, it stands alone.
It's like about the size of a first run Macintosh, but this is something that you and I played with when we went to the retro gaming show, and that was my first taste of it. And I was like, oh my God.
I hope they have. Speaking of old tech, next month in October, we'll be going to the retro gaming show expo here in Portland. And I think we've gone.
Bless their hearts.
It'll be our third year
yep.
going, I think.
Yep. Yeah, we love it.
You can find old computers, old cartridges, and a lot of people, I mean, in the dealer's room, a lot of people go there for old
parts. Parts and machines.
And gaming cartridges.
Yeah, hackable and all kinds of things.
Now, Vectrex did not catch on. Vectrex peaked and then fell off very quickly.
Fast.
And I remember it was Toys R Us, and there in the front of the store was a stack of Vectrexes they were trying to move because they weren't selling well.
Oh.
Again, I think, actually, maybe slightly post-Navy. Maybe I was still in the Navy, about to be, you know, kicked out. That's a different show. But I remember just the fact that there was no other system that was Vector Graphics. They just did not know how to market it, or did not know how to develop
it
because
looks
they cornered the market on Vectrex, Vectrex.
It looks like they had a great machine and no way to figure out how to get it to people to buy, because I don't understand why this, you know, didn't catch up like wildfire, because it was really fun.
Now I'm trying to show this game that we're looking at right
now. Asteroids-esque.
It was called Mindstorm, and this is the game that shipped with every Vectrex.
Right.
You know, the one game you got.
Which is a lot better than the tank game that shipped with the Atari 2600.
Oh, so much. But this is the whole idea that you had a self-contained video
Vector
game
graphics.
System.
Yes.
I think another one of their problems.
What was the price point
on it? Well, I believe it initially sold for $80. And then,
that's cheap.
And then they went down to 20.
That's incredible.
And I bought
cheap.
One of the $20 ones.
Oh, my God. Because the 2600 was more than that.
Right. And, you know, if I saved it for 30 years, it'd be worth $500. But come on.
Yeah.
I actually played with things when I bought them. I didn't save them to be, you know, to sell later.
Nope. Yeah.
But I did, at the time, recognize the uniqueness of it and really appreciate it. I mean, I played. There was, you know, there's a limitation to vector graphics. You have right angle. You can only deal with right angles. Yeah. Well, you can make, shape primitives. You can only deal basically with squares and
polygons.
Squares and triangles. Polygons. Yeah, you couldn't make curves.
Flat polygons.
Curved shapes.
Yeah.
But still, you can still do a lot with those. Look at Asteroids, which I think was a problem. They could not license Asteroids at the time.
If they could have licensed Asteroids. But see, Atari didn't want to give away their big maker. I understand why. But yeah, if they could have done that, then that may have. If they could have partnered with them, they probably would have stuck around.
Yeah, like or Atari, I don't know, buy Vectrex, and then or, I don't know. It was made by some other company. I think it was like General Consumer Electronics. And licensed or sold to Mattel. I think I have that right. But Mattel made a bunch of stumbles. Another thing that I didn't bring up, but I think it was wrong at the same time, was that another amazing thing they had besides Vectrex was that that camera that took
video. Vision.
Pixel Vision that took
oh man,
video on a cassette.
Yep.
On a regular cassette.
That could have been huge.
That could have been huge, and it was aimed at kids.
Yep. Although you can see a bit of it mentioned in the Linklater film Slacker. Somebody has a Vectrex, or not Vectrex, a Pixel Vision camera in the movie. There's a scene. But yeah. Again, early tech. Probably, I think there's probably still, a really big underground Pixel Vision market of people who still have cameras and still play with them. And
oh, yeah. I think it was like maybe in the 90s or the 2000s. And I said mid, I think I may have said 90s, I meant 80s, late 80s. But mid 90s for when I bought, late 80s when I bought this stuff. I think I said kept saying 90s. But in the, I remember in the 90s, there is a Pixel Vision, you know, fans or people who buy parts of. I bought one. I found one in Goodwill. Did not work. Could not get it to work.
Oh.
But I sold it here locally to a woman who I presume was a lesbian.
Okay.
But she brought her girlfriend. I think she just brought someone to make sure I wasn't some kind of, you know, weirdo. But she bought it with, and she seemed electronically savvy, like she was going to take it home and get the thing to work. But I so wanted that thing to work. But back to Vectrex. So I got two commercials for this because the second commercial sort of segues into the next thing we're going to talk about. So, yeah, Vectrex, amazing, unique. Vector graphics, home completely, and also their controller. See the front there. That's where the controller was stored.
Mm-hmm.
You could just pop it in and pop it out. And it had a nice feel, better than the Nintendo controller. Everything. I don't think it's really featured in this clip, but we're gonna move on to the next Vectrex clip so I can surprise you. I think it'll surprise you. I think those are Romulan birds of prey.
Oh no. Oh, that's great.
Yeah, Star Trek this was Star Trek Motion Picture.
Which for some people was probably more exciting than the film itself because there was very little explosions. Very few explosions and very little action like that in that movie for most people. But yeah, that they marketed the shit out of that movie, so I'm not surprised.
Yeah, and I think that this is probably, I don't know the particular history on this, but this is an overlay, by the way.
Yeah.
This is a piece of a plastic that went over the screen to give you color,
right,
and to indicate like the players and scoring and things like that.
I mean, wasn't that the thing about the Vectrex? It was a black and white.
It was a black and white monitor, and you had if you wanted color, you had to put these overlays on.
Right.
Now that's supposed to.
That looks like a sombrero.
That's supposed to be the refueling ship.
Okay. All right. I guess. I don't remember refueling ships in the Star Trek universe, but all right.
Well, they are in there. It's really...
I think they created this entire thing and then they simply literally slapped the Star Trek the Motion Picture on front of it, and called it that because it doesn't look Star Trek-y at all. But all right.
No, I think they tried to have now. Another place we're going to is the Pinball Hall of Fame in Vegas, also in October, and they had, and I actually remember actually playing it. They had the Star Trek the Motion Picture, talking about old tech.
Sit down, Sega game.
Vector graphics Sega game.
Yep.
And those ships looked like the
yep.
ships they were supposed to
yep.
be. And there was like even a game prologue, like they have like a cut scene where they lead you into the game. But I remember that was like so. Oh my god! It was so much fun. I hope it's working. I hope they got it to work this year.
I hope so too. I want to play it again.
If it's still there.
It's been forever since I played that game, but it's actually the one that you sit inside.
You sit inside and play
Star Trek.
Yes.
Awesome.
So, well, I, because we had started, we had talking about gaming, and there was a big gaming glut in the 80s, and also mm-hmm. a personal computer.
Well, yeah, when the market first like opened and then exploded, and Apple and Atari and Sinclair and all that. Suddenly, everybody was trying to create a personal computer because they saw it as the next big thing, like radio or television. It was the next big media market. That and maybe the compact disc. So the 80s seemed to be all about that. And I remember that because, like I said earlier, I was totally in on that. I was totally taken by it. I wanted one.
You wanted a personal computer?
Yes.
Yeah, I remember, because we're sort of binging a show now called Halt and Catch Fire.
Yes, right? AMC, which is television
on
screen.
AMC, which is about that time.
Right,
that
it's period. About the development of the industry. It's very much like what Mad Men was to advertising. Halt and Catch Fire is to a period in computer development, although instead of the late 50s to 60s, this is the early 80s to 90s, I believe. It's already like got four seasons, so we've got a lot of binging to do.
Oh, to catch up. Yeah, we do.
Mm-hmm. So we just started like yesterday. I just found it and when I was kind of doing research on other things and looking into graphics for other things.
And a lot of computers lost the battle.
Yeah, in fact, you'll see them at those retro gaming shows. You'll find sometimes tables where people will have like there will be a computer museum. In fact, I think I have pictures that I took of it that will show you all these different game systems that never survived, all these different computer systems that never survived, and then of course kind of the integration of the two, where the way to get people to buy personal computers was to piggyback on the gaming industry and say, oh, look, it's not just a gaming console like the Atari, but it's also a computer itself. And so there still are those, and there are still clubs of people that keep those things running and trade software and kit bash them to do things. Like I was looking at some videos of people who had figured out how to get a Commodore 64 or a VIC-20 to be able to look at Twitter or actually go online. And that was amusing and reminded me of when my very first experience of the internet was because I got a modem for my Commodore 64, and Lord knows how slow the actual capacity was, but I do remember going to the Chicago Sun-Times website, or not website, because there weren't websites then, but going to their computer on the internet and reading movie reviews by Roger Ebert, and I believe it was.
Really?
Or Gene Siskel. And that was my first experience of the internet, and I'm going, oh my God, this is going to be, you know, amazing.
Yeah.
But computers were there, like the fact that Studebaker isn't around anymore, Nash isn't around anymore. There are all these computer companies, just like at the beginning of cars, that decided to try and say, well, let's make a car. And a lot of the good ones, like Tucker, didn't become cars, but we still have the memory of them. And the same thing with computers. I mean, you know, no, Sony's still around, but the Betamax didn't survive the VHS onslaught. So there's a lot of computers that didn't make it through the wilderness that Apple and IBM PCs.
The Titans, yeah. Right. I remember like Trash 80.
Trash 80
didn't make it.
I'm surprised too, because they really were good at marketing.
Texas Instruments didn't make it. Hewlett Packard's still around, sort
HP's
of. HP's right?
Still around, but I think but
they're
they
always
bought Compaq.
They're always discounted.
They bought Compaq.
Oh, I remember. I had a Compaq.
They bought Compaq computers, so they kind of merged those two, and it turned out to not be good for them. But yeah, now you know everybody wants to create the next cell phone or the next app, or there's that whole thing, and there's going to be a litter of things that don't make it a phone. I mean, the Windows phone that I bought didn't, you know, they created the best camera phone on the market, and even with
it was amazing,
and they just turned around, it didn't sell well, so they just immediately dropped it and didn't support it. And maybe part of it was because it was a Windows, it ran the Windows phone OS instead of Android or iOS, so you know.
But I think it's a So you think it's moving toward like computers in your pocket? Not just a phone or a tablet or a phablet, but just an actual computer that you can carry. I mean, like a fully functional computer.
Well, that's what we already kind of have. You know,
really?
I mean, for all intents and purposes, we are carrying computers around in our pockets. They just happen to be phones. But people are using them less and less to talk on the phone to each other. In fact, most millennials will tell you they prefer to text. They don't want you to call them. They don't want to talk on the phone because it requires them to have a spontaneous loss of control moment. They have to stop what they're doing and pay full attention.
Focus their attention.
Correct.
Right.
So if you look at this, at where tech went, I mean, tech started as radio in terms of the way it impacted our lives.
Right.
Then it moved to TV. The TV turned into a game machine. The game machine turned into a computer. The computer turned into a phone. Everything is getting is gotten closer and closer to us. We didn't carry televisions around with us. It stayed in the home. But they have found a way to combine a television, a game console, a computer, and a telephone, which used to all be anchored at home, into a single device that can now fit in our pocket. So if you follow that curve of intimacy, the next barrier is going to be wearable and then internalized. So if you're going to project forward in terms of tech, the next places to go are implanted or projected directly onto like Google Glass or directly into your eyes and ears, or then eventually into your brain.
I don't like that.
I know. And there's going to be a huge pushback on that, and that's probably what's holding it back. But you know R&D is looking at that right now. I mean, they've already got RFID chips that you can inject into kids to track them and pets to track them and have a something that's like a chip in your hand that's got all your medical records on it and things like that. So, but that's another episode.
Yeah, well, yeah. I mean, you can get really bleak and say, oh, it'll be the death of conversation. It'll be the death of...
Well, it already is. You know. It's already killing it. Well, Sherry Turkle has written several books.
Who's Sherry Turkle?
Sherry Turkle wrote a book called Alone Together. She's an MIT scientist who was very early on studying tech. I think she used to write for Wired. She was a big cheerleader at the beginning, but now she's become more and more of an analytical skeptic, maybe even sometimes critic. And Alone Together was all about the ways in which social media was... To give you an image, it's like walking into a coffee shop now. Everybody there has the same has some version of the same device. Everybody there is doing the same thing. Nobody's talking to each other. So we are all alone together. Well, she recently wrote a book about the art of conversation and how that's being affected. About how her book Alone Together was about social media and how technology is changing it. And the social contract and, you know, the way that people are preferring robots to real people and things like that. The book's name I don't have on the tip of my tongue is about conversation and how it's being changed by technology and texting and phones and all that. So highly recommended.
Well, I wonder if this at least some of the people who pursue or collect old tech, or even like people that are regular visitors of the, I say regular consumers of the Retro Gaming Expo, because we don't buy a lot. We don't buy a lot when we go there. We just like to look. Mostly.
Right.
But I wonder if any of it is a rebellion against, you know, the
kind of anchor technology.
Well, you know, a callback to a simpler time.
Right.
You know, people,
right.
Because I think maybe there's some safety in that. You're not overwhelmed mm-hmm. by all the modern tech. You know, I like, you know, there's more than the nostalgia for the blocky graphics and the 8-bit sound.
And I think
there's a comfort.
There's even millennials
in the simplicity of it.
Who prefer that kind of 8-bit graphic stuff mm-hmm. as a retro kind of thing. I think for them it's like steampunk. You know, it's kind of a callback to an earlier time where it is simpler. And I think sometimes with technology, because this seemed like the major prime directive of technology was to make life easier and faster and quote unquote more convenient. And then there eventually becomes this backlash of, wait a minute, maybe faster isn't better. Maybe slower is better. Maybe working rather than having something done for you is better. Maybe having real conversations instead of text conversations, or real conversations, you know, live rather than voice messages or whatever. I think there is that kind of reconsiderative ebb and flow, tidal gravity that comes and goes, that in certain corners, people are going back and embracing, or at least trying to hold on to old tech. And I don't think it's just necessarily sentimental attachments, like, oh, I had one of those when I was a kid, so when I see that and touch it, smell it,
it's a reaction.
It's a thing. That there's actually a kind of, I don't want VR. I want to play Asteroids. I don't want, first-person shooter game. I want to play Oregon Trail again, because I had to think more, and I had to translate it into text rather than just aim a gun, pull a trigger, and kill somebody virtually.
Yeah, I mean, talk about old tech that died, or software. I had text games, mm-hmm. and Infocom was the mm-hmm. big maker, and I remember one of the fun ones was Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy.
Yeah.
Basically, it was an adventure.
Choose your own adventure?
Choose your adventure, a novel in text form.
In game
form? A novel turned into a game.
Like a maze.
Yes, yeah. And you would combine verbs and nouns. You would string together...
Commands.
You would string together... simple sentences,
right.
And you would get an answer. You would go advance farther in the story, like open the. You know, I guess, and I guess that's an offshoot of Dungeons and Dragons, kind of.
Yeah.
But you would say, open the door and look in. It would say, you know, the game would come back, be basically your DM, your dungeon master, and it would say, you know, there is a half-filled, there's a flask of half-filled clear liquid or something, and you know, and you could choose whether to drink liquid or take the flask and give it to someone later. So those didn't last long either, text games. I mean, they just got pummeled by video games.
Right. Yeah. Galaxian and Pac-Man and that whole onslaught.
And those were on floppies. Those were on the flexible floppies. So that's how old text adventure games were. But moving, since we're in the computer realm, I'm going to pull up this computer.
Yes, it's fun to think about the concept of antique computers.
Yeah.
You know? It used to be something
vintage computers.
Well, yeah, vintage. It used to be that something couldn't be quote unquote an antique until it was 50 years old or older. Well, now they can be.
This is a Commodore home computer system. With it, you can learn music. Take care of your household accounts, file your lists, type your letters, get into telecommunications, and entertain your family. But it all starts with the Commodore 64 or VIC-20. And now is the right time to start, because the price of all Commodore software is now up to 50% less. Commodore computers, in more homes than any other home computer.
And I was one of those homes, and I had two of them. I bought a VIC-20, and then when I saved enough money, I bought a Commodore 64. And I bought that big old brick of a floppy drive.
Oh,
that
right.
was $500.
It was so expensive. I had one, too.
$500. But when I got it, I was like, oh, my God, I can finally save everything, and I don't have to deal with that stupid tape recorder that could never get to work. So, yeah. I never had the dot matrix printer, though. But to this day, if I hear a sound of a dot matrix printer, it takes me back. It's like the mosquito sound of tech.
Yeah, I had the...
And I had the modem, too.
I had the 64. I did not have the VIC-20, but I had the 64. I didn't have the modem.
Mm-hmm.
I had the joysticks. I had the brick of a...
hard drive. I think it was heavy.
And I didn't have the tape player either.
Interesting.
And you remember that... I should just grab it. Now, if I can, and just bring that image up.
What?
This is the thing that you had to have, whether you had a video game or a... If you had a video game or a computer...
Yes.
You had to have that.
If you were doing... Yes. If there is a dividing line in tech, in old tech, there is everything before... when you needed this thing, and then everything after when you no longer needed this thing.
This was the
RF switch box that would switch you between your whatever device to use your television as a monitor and using your television again as a television. So I remember, yeah, that having to reach behind, because always in the back of the television. Those things, notice that cord right there, those wires. You they were never longer than that.
No, ever.
Why anybody didn't think, you know, maybe it would be great if we put like 2 feet of cable on this thing? No.
And you know what I had to unplug the rabbit ears or the antenna, whatever.
Otherwise, you'd get interference. Suddenly, you'd have like Merv Griffin or something playing over what you were doing on the computer.
Yes, you would have a ghost image of the TV broadcast.
No, I used to like to do that, though. I used to take that little slider switch, and I'd like to get halfway between.
Of course you did.
And it would be like, oh, you're not supposed to do this. Yeah, whatever. So, sure. Yeah, I remember those from having my VIC-20, and I remember that from when I had an Atari 2600, of course. That was my first experience with that.
Right, for your game and your computer.
Actually, I had Coleco Pong, Coleco's version of Pong, which was called Computer Tennis, I think.
And you were screwed if it broke.
Oh, it was gone. Yeah, it was like, no, television. You have nothing to watch your device on.
But yeah, so, yeah. I think you just said it. It's like you can sort of determine the age of a person by how
that
if
is
they remember
great,
this.
the great. Yeah, you show that to people and they or they go, "What is the hell is that?"
RF sweeper. Is it a? I don't know. What is that? Is that for your
TV? It's a personal transporter
system. With it, you can learn music.
See, now there you're looking at
care of your household
the actual
accounts,
Commodore monitor.
File your list.
You can get,
type your letters.
Much clearer.
Get into telecommunications.
Were clearer than televisions, but yep.
Right.
Yep.
But I didn't have the monitor either. I had to use a switch box for my
television.
For my TV.
Yep. Ah, yes.
I like the feel of the Commodore.
They had a
keyboard.
Key that was shaped very similar to a Selectric.
Ah.
That was part of it.
Is that why?
It had good keyboards. Yeah, and it was also nicely self-contained, too. The thing was easily moved and picked up, because if you're going to have to go sit by the television, that meant you were going to have to take your computer and, like, have it somewhere so it could store, you could, you know, carry it around. So it was a really good design.
Now another 80s Navy story. I bought a Commodore 64, and I played text adventure games. Games with a guy I had a crush on. He went on to be a Sailor of the Month and very cool guy. He was we both worked in administration and he was in charge of basically the accountant for the officers, keeping track of their pay and paying them and stuff. And but it was one of those, you know, if you meet him, you know. Appreciate them, but he was one of those cool straight guys. And I remember asking him on a break when we were playing a text, an Infocom text adventure game on a Commodore 64. I asked him, would you ever be interested in having sex with a guy? And he said, I'd rather kill myself.
Oh my God.
He didn't say it angrily.
No.
He was just like,
declarative.
Like maybe he had thought of it, and this is the conclusion he came to. I'd rather kill myself.
Fascinating.
I don't know what happened to him. Actually, I do know what happened to him since then. That'd be too much information on how to find him. You know, maybe he doesn't. But the Commodore 64, I held on to that until I got until it was time for me to be kicked out for homosexuality. Surprise, surprise, and. In the holding company, this is the barracks where they put everybody. That means the violent people, the mentally ill people, drug addicts. We all go into the same barracks before being discharged. And I had it in my locker. Anyway, I was still playing games with people. I had dropped the whole, crushes on people thing at the time because I was kind of disappointed. That's been kicked out for being gay. But... this is my first experience with a meth head because someone stole my Commodore 64 out of my locker. I woke up one morning and my locker had been forcibly opened, and all of a sudden, you know, it's like no one knew who did it. You know, whoever broke into it had to make a hell of a lot of noise. Mm-hmm. You know, when to steal my computer. I find out much later. Someone tells me who did it, and I said, "Why didn't you say anything?" He said, "I don't want to get involved." So, well,
oh,
fuck
wow.
you.
That's
you
know? Fucked up.
So, some tweakers stole my Commodore 64 out of my locker in the Navy.
And your introduction to the world of methamphetamine, right, secondhand, was unfortunate.
But since we're on the subject of Commodore,
yes,
let's bring this up.
Let's. This is not why I bought one, but it certainly didn't hurt.
Why buy just a video game from Atari or Intellivision? Invest in the wonder computer of the 1980s for under $300. The Commodore VIC-20. Unlike games, it has a real computer keyboard. With the Commodore VIC-20, the whole family can learn computing at home. Plays great games, too. Under $300, the wonder computer of the 1980s, the Commodore VIC-20.
Coming soon, Commodore brings you Gorf, the wonder arcade game, and that's Omega Racing.
They're showing you the arcade versions of the games, you'll notice.
Yeah.
But home, yes, good old, VIC-20. Using your own television.
The family can learn computing at...
Let me back it up. Yeah. Yes, your whole family you can.
Good old William Shatner. Yes, there's actually a still. I actually have two stills in the there of print ads that were William Shatner ads for Commodore computers, and he was a spokesperson for them before the VIC 20. He was a spokesperson going all the way back to the PET computer, the one that I played with in or first used in Seattle, and as a joke, or a reference point or a callback or whatever, the set designers of Star Trek II: The Wrath of Khan placed one in his apartment. And if you look in the scene that we're showing you right there, that computer in the background there is not supposed to be a Star Trek Starfleet terminal. It's supposed to be an antique computer that James Tiberius Kirk has that just happens to be the model that William Shatner was selling in the computer of the 1980s. This one was in the 70s, though. And there it is back there. There's even a little blinking cursor. It's like way too big, but it's blinking big so that you can actually see it during the scene.
So you say that he was selling Commodore back when this?
Yes.
The first computer?
PET was
the Commodore made?
The PET you're looking at here, mm-hmm. That's like late 70s. That was one of the first personal computers you could get, and it was so expensive that I'm pretty sure you would only find it in schools.
Oh.
But yeah, in fact, there's a machine that's even earlier than that PET that had an even smaller screen on it, and I think that was probably like 76, 77. And I believe Shatner was already on board at that point, because there, I think one of the pictures I have that he's holding is he's holding a PET, because they also made business computers as well. Commodore did. It was a Canadian company.
Oh.
But I believe he was still, as you can see, the computer of the 80s. The VIC-20 was like 80, 81, 82. So they didn't put a VIC-20 in his apartment, you'll notice, but that was what he was selling. Even as he was making this movie, he was a spokesperson for Commodore still.
I just love the design of the PET. It looks like something out of 2001.
It does. In fact, it's interesting that you asked about where it was in terms of the development, because this is actually an older computer than the VIC-20 or the Commodore 64. This is kind of the first one. And you notice it looks more business computery. It looks more like a terminal.
And there's a tape drive built into
yes,
it, right?
Yes, there is. But yeah, so that's the in-joke kind of Easter egg thing in Star Trek II: The Wrath of Khan that I don't think I noticed the first like four or five times I saw the movie. But later when I read about that, and I mean, you know, I look for it every time I see that scene now.
I wonder if Shatner noticed.
Oh, he had to have. Because everything else, what's interesting is everything else in the apartment is an antique.
Oh.
There's guns on the walls. Right. There's all this. So you see that he's into antiques, which is why when McCoy brings him these glasses in the scene, it's kind of fitting that he's giving him an antique solution to his vision problem.
I really like the shape of that PET computer. I'm sure it's some...
The pyramid.
Some people have... sort of taken the case and built something else into it.
Oh, I would love to make an aquarium out of one. I think it's wonderful. But, and again, it's probably sentimental, but I so associate that computer with my first touching and working with an actual computer. And it thrilled me as a kid so much. I had to be like, you know, 12. And I just thought it was the coolest thing in the world. It's like, I have to have one of these. So, yeah, that was like, you know, one of the birthplaces of my old tech. Although I was already playing around with typewriters just to play with them because I like typing when I was like 7 or 8. So, yeah.
Oh, we went dark.
We went dark for a minute, yes. Hmm.
What is that?
I hear music.
Yes. Well, we've come to the end of another episode.
Yes, we have, but we will now, for those of you who may not be...
Please subscribe to our YouTube channel.
Yes, please.
If you're watching the video, you will see a subscribe button. It's Bad Maria's eyeball on the lower right. Click
Correct.
On that.
And when you subscribe, there's a little bell, and if you click on that bell, it will also email you a reminder whenever we are on the air live or, you know, do stuff. Of course, we have a Facebook page. It's facebook.com/gaynerdlove, so that's easy to remember. We'll post things there. We'll post links to the videos that we talked about today, as well as, you know, stuff throughout the week.
All right. And we have a Twitter account, @gaynerdlove.
These are all very easy to remember. There's just no excuse not to, like, find these and follow them and you know, reply, too, to stuff. Repost stuff that we post and reply. Tell us what you think. Tell us if we're full of shit. Or tell us memories that you have of your old tech.
Now, YouTube, Bad Maria Prods on YouTube. Bad Maria Productions is the, you know, the production entity, basically my
creative hub.
Yeah, for all
your
my
umbrella
for all my projects and Gaynerd Love is just one of many projects, which you can also find on the Bad Maria Prods website.
We are prodding you to do this.
Yeah, if you go to badmariaprods.com, you will see an icon for Gaynerd Love, and you click on that, and you will see all episodes available.
All 60 episodes. This is our 60th episode.
That's right.
Of Gaynerd Love, as well as other assorted great efforts of creativity that you, Archie, have done.
Oh, having a cursor problem. La la la
la. Curse. You know, there's a reason they call it a curse.
So until next time.
Yes.
I Gaynerd love you, Andy.
I Gaynerd love you, Archie.
Gaynerd Love is a project of Bad Maria Productions.
We really don't have to do this.